So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, friends, depending upon which part of the world you are joining us from. Once again, we are with you with one and only Mr. Suresh Lulla, who is a distinguished alumnus of the IIT Bombay, and he has made a mark through his work in the field of quality. Mr. Lulla, you all know, pioneered the quality movement in India by setting up the Kimpro Consultants in 1987. Often referred to as the quality guru of India. He was mentored by Dr. J.M. Juran, the father of quality, who along with Mahatma Gandhi and Sri Ramakrishna Bajaj formed the trinity of Mr. Lulla's role models. And he jokes that one thing he has in common with them is a bald head. That's for his sense of humor. Kimpro has served reputed Indian business houses, MNCs, SMEs, and hospitals. Collectively, these clients have saved in excess of 25,000 crores as a byproduct of quality improvement, specifically by strategically addressing their cost of poor quality. I think I like to just read by what Dr. Mashelkar, one of the doyens of the researchers in the country, the national research professor, what he had to say about Lulla, that I have observed with great admiration the evolution of Kimpro over the past two decades, now much more. What differentiates Kimpro is its singular passion for transforming Indian organizations and their human resources into world-class quality assets. Examples abound. In addition, I have personally experienced the transparent and robust processes Kimpro follows for recognizing individuals, teams, and organizations. I consider each of these three processes themselves emerging as best practices. So here we are for this present format of our conversation with Mr. Suresh Lulla. We will consider it as the last, and we will probably re-emerge with a little different format after discussing with all of you. So over to Suresh Bhai.
Thank you, Dr. Vijay Agarwal. Your introduction is always so warm and laced with humor. We all know that Dr. Agarwal is synonymous with National Pulse Polio Program. Did you know Dr. Agarwal was a student leader? That he led resident doctors to strike for 100 days? That he is the Kimpro Platinum Standard Healthcare of 2019? Now, quality fables are not about fiction and animals. They're about fiction and facts from organizations that we have dealt with. They're based on real experience and involve real people. The quality fable that follows demonstrates an as is flow diagram is an excellent tool for diagnosis. It's probably the most universally accepted tool for quality. You can't construct a flow diagram sitting in a room. One must walk through a process and flowchart what you see as is while interviewing operators along the flow. The solution to a problem does not have to be complex. problem solving, quality improvement are not rocket science. Sometimes the solution is so simple that you wonder, why didn't I think of it before? Let's move to red bags, green bags. This is based on my assignment with a benchmark hospital in Thailand. The vice president of finance, a European at this hospital, realized the hospital was spending far too much money on replacement linen. It was a chronic problem. As a result, the senior management appointed a cross-functional project team to solve the mystery of the missing linen. During the problem diagnosis phase, the team brainstormed about possible hypotheses for vanishing linen. Since the problem was very focused, it entailed convergent thinking. By that I mean, you're not going to get lots of ideas in your brainstorming, but you will get few ideas from intelligent people. For example, the supplier of linen was probably delivering substandard products. The ambulance van were running inadvertently off with the linen. Linen was hoarded by staff. The demand for linen was far greater than the supply. Few ideas. On analysis, none of these hypotheses would be validated. So what did the team do? The team, to find the root cause, emerged on a flowcharting exercise. Flowcharting the linen distribution across the hospital, start to end. Without a doubt, the linen was disappearing in the operation theater. Hospital procedures dictated that any linen coming in contact with blood be placed in plastic bags of a certain thickness. Therefore, the linen in the operation theater was dutifully placed in plastic bags of the specified thickness. It turned out that the only plastic bags of the specified thickness were red. Red colored bags were used for biohazardous waste. The hospital procedures clearly states that all biohazardous waste must be destroyed. Inadvertently, the linen was going up in smoke. As remedial action, the hospital purchased green plastic bags of the right thickness for bloody linen. In the first year itself, it saved $500,000, and I'm referring to 1996. What are the lessons we learned? Chronic problems do not have an alarm system. When the only alarm for chronic problems is when we proactively translate it into the language of management, which is money. You remember it was the VP Finance who spotted the problem. All hypotheses need to be validated. An as-is flow diagram is an excellent tool for diagnosis. I can't tell you, it's not rocket science, but it has to be mapped with integrity. See, you document what you see and interpret the document. Documented procedures must be specific and detailed, or you're going to have linen going into the wrong bags. The solution to a problem does not have to be complex. Over to you, Dr. Agarwal.
Thank you, Sudesh Bhai. The beauty of your stories is always that they are so simple and they stimulate you to think of much deeper into the complex healthcare systems. Unfortunately, the solutions in the healthcare segment may not always be that simple as it might have come in this story. But what I can say is that there is a linen story going around almost in every department and in every area. And the basic teaching that you have done is that you have to walk through the process to understand where are we erring, where can we go wrong. And towards that, in today's date, for example, now if you see hospitals are struggling for oxygen. And I can tell you that in every hospital, there will be a significant amount of oxygen that is being wasted. It is being wasted when a patient takes it out of his nose, so the oxygen is just flowing. And it will be wasted when the patient may be having 99% oxygen, and we don't require that much oxygen. So you require to titrate it less. In fact, right at this moment, I can see Lalu Joseph joining, and she has done a great amount of the, I would say, on this subject of oxygen conservation in CMC Vellore and the problems where, how can we conserve oxygen? So while we are at this, I'll hand it over to Lalu to explain how we are buying liquid oxygen, we convert it into gaseous oxygen, how all this kind of a thing, and how we may be incurring losses in the hospitals. Yeah, Lalu.
Yeah, I don't know if I'm the right person, sir, but with my limited knowledge, I can tell you I actually had no knowledge about oxygen prior to this pandemic. So now with the kind of stress on oxygen supplies and problems, I actually have been pushed into managing the oxygen supply here. But let me tell you, this is one area where we never thought that we will have to really, you know, a time will come that we are going to be monitoring oxygen supply. So only now actually I've got the clue of the entire last 1.5-2 months, I should say, of the entire situation. Now, considering only the liquid medical oxygen, as Dr. Agarwal mentioned, you know, the liquid medical oxygen that we buy is in tons. So it's actually coming in a huge cryogenic container in tons, and it goes to an area, it gets weighed, and then it comes to your establishment. After that, it is filled in tankers, which are, you know, not mobile, those are static ones, in kiloliters, but you are charged in cubic meters of liquid. So there's a conversion, weight to volume there, of liquid. And after that, it is supplied through piped lines. And while it is supplied to the patient, it is actually calculated in liters per minute of gas. So from a liquid to a gaseous state, and multiple metrics jumping from one metric to the other metric to the third metric, and every cryogenic tank has a conversion ratio also. So you have to consider that, to what extent you can fill, what is the conversion, what are the losses. So we never really bothered looking into all this from time immemorial, I should say. So that's one aspect. So end of the day, how much is coming in and how much is actually being utilized, there's a huge gap. So that's why we are not able to actually calculate the consumption versus how much is actually coming in as cryogenic source. So that's one part of it. Then the second aspect is, we never really look at wastages. So if you look at it, you have your piped medical oxygen supply, and most often the terminal end at the ward side or ICU end are all open, because it's just flowing. You really don't know whether the valves are closed at all. And often the flow meters are not connected also. That's one aspect. And the second thing is, the patient, you may put him on a face mask. After some time, he'll remove that and he'll throw it on his, bedside. And that's actually super saturating the linen also. And that's why you're ending up having accidents happening. And for, he's not using it, but that's getting wasted. And sometimes if you're not monitoring for probably 10 to 15 minutes, that's lying there. While the patient is having food, it's lying there. While he's drinking a cup of coffee or tea or chatting over the phone, it's lying there. That's the second aspect. And the third is what Dr. Agarwal mentioned. You may not want to really saturate them up to 99%. It's good enough 95-96%. But often that titration doesn't happen. In the morning, okay, 4 liters of oxygen. So throughout the shift, it is 4 liters of oxygen. Nobody is typically looking at the saturation and to see whether, you know, you may want to downgrade that to 2 liters of oxygen or 1 liters of oxygen. He is maintaining saturation. So those standing orders are not maintained. Only now everybody is jumping into it with short supply. So there's huge amount of wastage also. And there are leakages that are happening. You can't really detect unless it's at the manifold end, you know, because it's a concentrated area where if there's quite a lot of oxygen there, you know, okay, there is leakage. But otherwise it is piped oxygen lines that are going, and that's actually diluting in the atmosphere. So you really don't know whether, unless there's a real pressure drop, otherwise you don't know. So there are leakages in the system, huge wastage everywhere. So there's a real gap between what is supplied and what is utilized. That's what I have understood in the limited time.
Well, you sound like an engineer.
Finally.
Yeah, you have analyzed the problem. But have you done an autopsy, flow charting as is, and estimating the waste at each stage? It won't be rocket science to save a lot of waste. It'll call for certain strict procedures. And I'm sure Dr. Agarwal has his inputs on this. But thank you for your very technical explanation. What are the other chronic problems in this pandemic in running a hospital? Oxygen is screaming and people are doing firefighting. It's not fire prevention. Our job as qualities is to do fire prevention. What are the other chronic problems in the pandemic while running a hospital? One sees a lot of queues outside the hospital. I'm sure there are many other wastages, not to mention the exhaust doctors.
I would like to say that besides oxygen, in hospitals, that is a system of a pilferage, I will say.
If you may ask me, I will say there's so much of duplication. Duplication of work.
Duplication of work.
Yes. So, you know, you will notice that certain areas where the both nurses and doctors are almost doing the same job, like documentation. What can be done by one group is being done by multiple groups. And end of the day, which I always say, you know, there is something when the patient gets admitted, you ask him, not during pandemic per se, when the patient gets admitted, you ask him, do you have any allergies? Are you diabetic? Do you have any food allergy? Do you have any medication related allergy? One group will document that the patient is diabetic, has penicillin allergy. And the other group will also ask the same question and will document something else. So there are discrepancies. There's duplication, wastage of time to a large extent with, you know, lack of clarity of jobs. That's one. Second thing is, you know, I'm not going to look at that person's documentation. That is my documentation. This is mine. So this kind of a little kingdom silos, you know, rather than working as a team. That is something that I have noticed. Lot of time and energy gets wasted there, duplication. Then when it comes to medication, you know, you tend to order more, keep things as ward supplies. You may not use them at all, but that's a general practice. And then you end up with expired drugs sitting in your ward, too many supplies being ordered and kept as ward stock, without even looking at a micro store. The concept of micro store is lacking. So you say everything is emergency, everything is urgently needed. But if you really look at it, half the stock you would not have used for even 6 months, and then you end up throwing them. That's another major wastage with supplies that I notice. Yes.
Any other process that is pandemic specific? That is.
Yeah, a lot of processes are complicated. For example, this is one industry where you develop your processes not around the patient, but your healthcare providers. I may be wrong. To simplify the work of the healthcare providers, you develop processes and you make it very, very complicated for the users. So therefore, it is like, you know, typically I had gone to a hospital where for the process of refund of what I have paid, you know, my parents were admitted. It was like going to n number of counters, getting signatures from n number of people to return, collect 1,200 rupees back. So you waste about 3 hours of time. Little do they realize that I have sat in 6 queues. I have stood in, you know, I actually was there in 6 queues and there were 6 people endorsing that and making me collect the 1200 rupees, which probably could have been done by one person in one queue. So you're using 6 people, because that one person, instead of spending 15 minutes, is actually 6 people spending 45 minutes, and the patient is walking 6 queues. So I typically feel, looking at many, many hospitals in my experience in the last 13, 14 years working with hospitals and also as an assessor, that we design our systems and processes to facilitate and suit our healthcare providers rather than the receivers. I may be totally wrong. This is my opinion. Yeah.
I would want maybe Lallu to also say that how medicines is another area where there is a huge amount of mismatch between what we procure and what we consume, and they get into expired medicines and pilferage. So that's where I would say, like the amount of money that you are focusing on linen, I would say medicines is another area where this can be a very important thought process for the healthcare providers to look at it. Yeah. Lallu, maybe you can.
I did mention that.
May I just add something?
Yes, sir.
I have had the good fortune of working in approximately 20 hospitals in India and neighboring countries, including Karachi. And the one common problem, two common problems across all of them, admissions process and discharge process. Unlocks capacity. It unlocks a lot of beds. Now, in the pandemic, are we carrying forward this problem of admissions and discharge and beds availability?
I should say we have become super efficient in pandemic. We should ask all our panelists now, what is their opinion?
Yeah, so guys, please mute yourself and you can start talking. I'm sure there you have come across many, many examples of where we can work towards stopping the wasteful expenditure in the hospitals. And we need your inputs for that.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Dr. Charan here, ma'am.
Go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. So actually what we've seen during this pandemic is that, of course, I totally accept with the oxygen wastage, because firsthand, when I've been even in the COVID wards, I've seen an umpteen number of patients who take off their mask. One, because the mask is uncomfortable. Probably for such patients, we could prefer cannulas, nasal cannulas, for whom probably the masks are like, it serves as a hindrance, and because of which they tend to waste the oxygen. And another one is also like, for example, in the molecular labs and testing, during the first wave, there were a number of tests being taken up and all that. So people tended to order more than what was required, the quantity of the testing, the media for testing, and of course the kits and all that. But all of them have a very short shelf life. So what has happened is, once they've crossed their almost near expiry, though I wouldn't say that they've actually reached the expiry time, but since they were stored for long periods of time, even like 2 to 3 months of being stored here, all of them, we found that they started having false positives. And we had to repeat a number of times those tests. So it was a kit wastage, manpower wastage, and of course the processing. So it was like even a delay to the patients, the turnaround time for the patients. So this was one major wastage which I actually faced during this intermediate phase between the first and second pandemic too, ma'am, and during the second. And needless to say, the medicines, because sometimes we hoard the medicines. So there were a number of medicines which, like, for example, even HCQ, like initially they said that was like the wonder drug. Now it has come to like the ivermectin, and it's almost out of question itself. So hoarding of medicines and then reaching their expiry date, that is another major wastage which we faced actually. So these are the kind of areas where we've actually faced it, ma'am.
It's brilliant, Dr. Sharon.
Yeah. Good evening, Dr. Lalu and Dr. Agarwal. I thought I should tell you something about the way the procurement is done in many of the hospitals now, especially in the COVID times. What is happening is now in hospitals like maybe Apollo Group or MGM or many other hospitals, Mehta Hospital, you have about 4,000, 5,000 line items in the pharmacy. And sometimes we hold large amounts of inventories of A value items and B value items and C value items. So now we have done ABC analysis of all those items, and you can automatically send out orders on an e-procurement platform. And this e-procurement platform connects to the vendors directly into their ERP systems, like maybe Wondersoft, Vanigam, or something like that. So once these ROILs and ROQs are set up, the orders go directly to them, and they dispatch the material and they send e-invoices. And these e-invoices, when they come here, they become GRNs, draft GRNs. And so we don't have to prepare GRNs for about, say, 300 or 400 materials that are supplied in a week or so. So we were able to reduce the manual GRNs, making manual GRNs for about 1,200 invoices that were received in a month. So we are trying to use techniques like RPAs and things like the robotic process automation. And it has really reduced the inventory by almost 30 to 40%. And this platform, the procurement platform, is not expensive, and all of us can try that, I believe. Already now, hospitals like Agarwal Hospital, Kauai Medical Center, Baby Memorial Hospital, our hospital, all those hospitals are using this e-procurement platform, which is very popular in manufacturing industries.
Thank you,
So use of technology will definitely be looked at for reducing waste. But we want some more examples. Have identified, just like the green bag and the red bag.
We have Neha, Dr. Neha with us. Dr. Neha, would you want to add on?
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. Yes, ma'am, I just want that in order to reduce the wastage, right? When we get a patient admitted in an emergency or in any of the situation during COVID timing, so when a patient get admitted in the hospital, so we order a large number of medicines for that patient, right? So in order to reduce that wastage, should there be a protocol followed by the NABH hospitals, or there should be a proper checklist that you should recommend in order to reduce the wastage of the drugs and medicines that should be procured in a proper timing? And in order to reduce that wastage, should there be a checklist?
Yeah, thanks for that, Dr. Neha. We do understand. So the problem that you are bringing out is over-ordering. Yes, there are a lot of solutions. I'm sure Suresh sir will come out with solutions for all the problems that we are talking about. Okay, so let's leave the solutions to him and how to go about analyzing that. If anyone else has any other problem to talk about, you know, what are the wastages that we are encountering? I see Lichi Vargi is there. Lichi?
Good evening, everyone. My point is not very specific to pandemic time, but in general, when I was in 2 years back, when I was in the hospital, we spent a lot of time to prepare consent forms in English and then translate into Malayalam. So why can't we, if any hospital spend a lot of time on such documents, why can't we share these documents in common platforms of CAHO or NABH, so that hospitals can spare their time of their employees spending particularly not the the middle level. Usually these kind of things are being done by middle level managers. So it is better if we can share, even in the name of the hospital, editable version. People can use it. What is your opinion?
Perfect. I think you got a very valid point, Litty. So, exactly, it is rework. I talked about multiple people doing the same work within the organization. Now we are talking about different hospitals doing the same type of work, duplicating and wasting time. So yes, we are coming out with the template, standardized one. That's certainly the solution. But yes, it's a problem. Okay. So now, shall we pass on to Suresh sir for dissecting all these problems that we talked about and giving us some way forward? Over to you, sir.
That's a tough one, Dr. Lalu. You don't get a solution straight away, but what you need to be very, very clear is how you've defined your problem. You know, so often we end up solving a problem. We end up solving a problem that no one wanted a solution to. So it is for your apex team to be able to identify what are the chronic problems in your organization. What are those areas of concern? Now, you mentioned medicines is one of your areas of concern. You mentioned oxygen is one area of concern. Within this, there would be several chronic problems. Now, that chronic problem has to be diagnosed. And there's no shortcut to it. So even NABH says there's a continual improvement chapter. Do hospitals actually implement continual improvement? If they did, they would have caught these problems much earlier. The fact is, continual improvement is seen as a nuisance value and additional will do in some time. And everything that is conformance related in the NABH, you do. So to make your NABH vibrant, you need to build a culture of CQI, continued quality improvement. That'll automatically create a culture of recognizing a chronic problem and defining it correctly. When you have a chronic problem, the problem decides the team. Not the team, the problem. We tend to create teams first to go and solve problems. The apex should know what are the problems, people impacted by the problem as an input, supplier, operator, customer, should be members of that team. That's one comment I can make, because right now we seem to be in a firefighting mode. You're treating the symptomatic evidence of a problem.
Very, very true. I think you got it very correctly. We tend to firefight, and I think we are very good in that, without actually going in depth and diving into these and trying to sort out the, finding out the actual cause or causes and trying to address those.
That is CQI.
Yeah.
And you manage in NABH.
My learning from today's story, Suresh Bhai, is that the hospitals are made of tons of processes, and those processes are left, then to just remain like that, that actual process is happening something else than whatever is the written process. So when the deviations start to happen, we don't even come to know. And therefore, some of those processes obviously will give rise to a more problem, more chronic problem than others. And therefore, I would say that number one, each process in the hospital should be kind of looked after like a baby whose development, whose nurturing should be very well looked after. So we have to continue to monitor processes. And of course, we need to continue to identify the chronic problems. That's where we may have to revise those processes which are contributing to those chronic waste and problems. That will be my takeaway from your story. Am I right about it? So you may say that.
As I mentioned in my story also in the lesson, chronic problems don't come with an alarm. They're buried. You have to analyze it through a flowchart and identify those wastes that are creating havoc in your process cycle time, response time. Are your processes faster, better, cheaper than yesterday? And the day before? It's a continual process. It's not a project and then forget it. Make it part of job design. Make it part of your performance appraisal, promotion policy. Improvement has to be in the DNA of any hospital management.
So thank you very much, sir. I think, as we said, this probably is the end of our present mode of the conversation, but we will reassemble, I think, more with this online meeting where we may have invited people. We may have up to 100 people who can join and kind of discuss on to the some operational issues in the hospitals or something. We'll reconvene this forum. But thank you very much, Suresh Bhai. You have been a great teacher, a great storyteller, and we are really, really fortunate that we have been listening it right from you. Anything, Lalu, you would like to add to this farewell conversation speech?
No, I don't really consider this as a farewell thing, because we will need to bring in a better version of this. That's about it. So maybe it's a good idea to have, you know, people join as a round table, invited people who are really interested in this. Now, this group of 55, 60, I noticed that they join every time. So obviously there is an interest to learning. So I think we have to go into a real systematic approach here, as Mushraf Ali has put down. A systematic approach and culture of improvement is the key. Certainly that is the key. So we will also have to rebrand this program in a way that we are going to become more and more engaging with our participants and guiding them, getting involved with them. So that's the way I look at it. And it's been a great experience, and we all continue to learn under the able leadership of Suresh sir. And let's really look forward to a rebranded version.
You're talking of continual improvement.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much. And
thank you.
Thanks everyone for joining. And thanks once again to Suresh Bhai.